Prime Minister Tony Abbott will join world leaders, including President Barack Obama and President Vladimir Putin, tomorrow for remembrance ceremonies at Normandy in France. It's the 70th anniversary of one of the most dramatic days in history, D-Day. Let's take a look back.
The beginning of the end for Nazi Germany. With the Allied invasion of Normandy on D-Day in 1944, 5,000 ships in the largest armada ever assembled, landing 130,000 troops with thousands more paratroopers, combining to seize five codenamed beaches, Utah, Omaha, Gold, Juno, and Sword. Despite setbacks and heavy casualties, the risky operation worked. It's been celebrated in countless books and in movies such as The Longest Day and Steven Spielberg's Saving Private Ryan.
You stay here, you're dead now!
3,000 Australians, mostly aircrew, fought in the battle, and the honour roll records 18 of them who died.
Author and journalist Peter FitzSimons has written several books about World War II history, and he joins us now. Let's make him welcome. Pete, welcome back to the couch.
Thank you.
Can you clear something up for us to begin with? What's D-Day? D in D, they actually stand
for? It's long disputed. You know, there's all sorts of theories. The French love it, for they said it was le jour de disembarcation.
Ah. That sounds good.
Disembarking off the
Yes, disembarking boat. Off the boats. So you off all the vessels and the landing gear and so forth. There was a military appellation in the First World War, which is this company will attack at H hour on D Day. So it started in the First World War, and it's one of those things that sort of meant different things to different people. The other one was Eisenhower said it was Departure Day. So it meant everything to everybody, the designated day of landing. The other thing I'd say is it just sounds good, doesn't it?
You know, really
D-Day,
yeah.
And
really
it's made
does.
For every pot boiler there ever was, every movie, Saving
there
Private
Ryan.
There was
a movie, though, wasn't there, D-Day, 6th of June?
Oh,
I think
yes.
There was one, a big, long, epic one that had... And everybody, every famous star at the time.
It's the most dramatic military action there ever was, because as somebody who works in, you know, telling stories and war stories, the thing about that, you had on the one side the Germans, the pure evil of the Nazis, not the Germans, but the Nazis with the Holocaust. So whatever's happening, it's in that one, it's not hard to work out where the goodies and the baddies are. In that one, we were absolutely the goodies because we were invading France to take France back from the Germans and stop the Holocaust, ideally.
So tell us then about the landing. What actually happened? Because did the Allies play quite a clever sort of role of deception?
Yes, there was all of that, but it was interesting. So you go back to Dunkirk. So Dunkirk went from the 27th of May to the 4th of June 1940. And Dunkirk is you get 380,000 trapped British troops off the beaches of France. You get them away. Churchill becomes the new Prime Minister, or has just become the new Prime Minister. And in the famous line, he says, "We will fight them in France. We will fight them on the beaches. We'll fight them on the air. We'll fight them on the landing grounds. We'll fight them in the streets and on the fields." And D-Day was the embodiment of that, so that they all got away. 380,000 got away in May of 1940. Then you go 3 years forward.
We ought to say, because a young girl asked me the other day, she said, "Isn't Vietnam World War II?" You see, we assume everyone knows, but, you know, D-Day was when all the little ships and boats and things from England went across to Dunkirk and loaded them up and rowed and sailed them back to...
That's right, they commandeered every single vessel they could get their hands on, every little fishing boat.
Took the troops off and took them back to Britain.
My father, who fought, and my mother both served in the Second World War. Dad taught us an editorial about Dunkirk, which was there in such a harbour as never existed on earth before. The rags and blemishes of democracy fell away, and it's a most amazing story. And as you mentioned in your intro, 3,000 Australians were there. You said 18 died. I thought 14 died.
Well, I had 14 this morning.
Yeah. Anyway, either way, we lost our men. And the most wonderful thing we've just seen in Paris, and I love France, but we had our guys were honoured there. We had seven of our veterans who were in the air. They go to the Arc de Triomphe, they lay their wreaths, and the French don't forget. You know, when you go to, if you go to Villers-Bretonneux, and you go to that's First World War, of course, but you go to the school and it says above it, "N'oublions jamais l'Australie." And it's wonderful. And the other thing, I suppose my field that I'm interested in, the Nancy Wake. So what happened after Dunkirk is Churchill again, I'm not doing a good Churchill impression, but he said, set Europe ablaze. Mm. And the idea was, we'll arm the resistance, we'll organise the resistance. So Nancy Wake was one of those. And when the D-Day landing happened, you had the resistance rises because the Germans rushed from everywhere to get to Normandy. The resistance rises and in with Nancy Wake, blowing up bridges, launching ambushes. I can see your producer going to wind up. I'm not. I barely cleared
my
throat.
It's such a good story. We're all hanging on every word. You're such a good storyteller. Peter FitzSimons, thank you very much for joining us on the couch.